Next talk is Eduard Горбунов from Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology. Eduard, please start.
Hello, everyone. Let me share my screen. Okay. Could you see the slide, the title slide?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Okay. Hello, everyone, once again. So today I will present our joint work with Konstantin Burlachenko, Zhizi Li, and Peter Echtarik from KAUST. This paper is about, this talk is based on the paper about fast non-convex distributed learning with compression. And this paper was accepted to ICML 2021. So here are my co-authors. And here you can see on the slide, you can see the brief outline of my talk. So I will start with the description of the problem. Then I will introduce compression operators, namely unbiased compression operators. After that, I will describe some classical approach to introduce compression to parallel methods like quantized gradient descent and Diana. And after that, I will introduce our new method called Marina and explain the benefits of our approach. And after that, in conclusion, I will show some numerical experiments with those methods. By the way, if you have any questions, you can interrupt me during the talk. Okay, so we consider classical distributed centralized optimization problem. Here X is parameters of the model, D is number of parameters, and the goal is to minimize an average of n functions, f of x, and each function is stored on some device, client or peer, and they are connected with in a centralized way with a trusted server. So for example, local loss functions fi can represent some loss on some model or on the part of the data stored on the ith client. And in the paper, we consider general cases when fi is an expectation of some stochastic function, or in particular, it can be a finite sum. But in this talk, I will focus more on compression, and I will not touch the stochastic algorithm with stochasticity from coming from the problem. So we will deal with the stochasticity only from compressions. So, and this is, in such systems, communication is a bottleneck typically, and this is a classical federated learning setup. So since the communication is a bottleneck, one need to somehow handle this. And there are a number of approaches. For example, if it's possible, one can change the topology of the network and, for example, remove the server and consider some decentralized optimization methods on some graph. Or alternatively, one can do more work on each worker in the hope of communicating less. For example, do more local steps of some gradient method or more sophisticated method. And this leads us to local SGD or federated averaging type of methods. But in this talk, we will focus on another approach. And this approach is based on sending less information at each communication route in order to reduce the overall communication cost. And for example, instead of sending dense vectors, workers can send some compressed or sparse vectors that approximate the initial vectors. And as I said, we study this approach. And before we introduce classical methods, we need to introduce the definition of unbiased compression, or sometimes it's called quantization. So it is basically just stochastic operator Q, and it's unbiased stochastic mapping. So expectation of Q of X is X, and it has relatively bounded variance. So the variance is bounded by some factor omega times the squared norm of the input vector x. For example, one can consider rand k operator where k components are picked uniformly at random. And here we consider five-dimensional vector. And for example, we can randomly pick, for example, the first and the fourth component. And also we need this multiplicative factor to make the resulting vector an unbiased estimate of the initial one. So here the denominator 2 is number of picked components, and here we have the dimension of the problem 5. So in general, here we will have d over k, and in general one can show that rand k operator satisfies this definition with the following omega. Okay, so and probably the most natural way how to introduce compression to parallel methods is quantized gradient descent. So it works as follows. At each iteration, server broadcasts the parameters xk in the current model to the clients. Then clients compute the gradients using their private data. And after that, they compress the obtained gradients and send them back to the server. After that, the server updates the parameters using the following update rule. And it can be seen as an SGD step with the following stochastic gradients GK. One can easily check that GK is an unbiased estimate of the true gradient, of the gradient of the whole function. And that is why I say that this is an SGD, stochastic gradient descent. And after that, steps 1 to 5 are repeated. The natural question appears, what is the convergence rate of this method? So in the beginning, I say that we focus on non-convex optimization problems. And basically, we need to, first of all, in non-convex optimization, in contrast to convex optimization, we cannot guarantee that we converge to some global solution. We can guarantee that we find some approximation of the stationary point. And in this, now I would like to show you the complexity bound for finding epsilon stationary points. So before that, I need to introduce two assumptions. The first one is that the objective function is uniformly lower bounded. And this is natural because otherwise the initial problem does not make sense. And we also need to introduce smoothness of the objective. So, and we actually assume smoothness of each individual local loss function. So that the gradient of the local loss function is Li smooth. Yeah, and under this assumption, one can show that QGD finds an epsilon stationary point. That epsilon stationary point means that x hat is epsilon stationary point if this satisfies, this inequality satisfies. So one can show that QGD finds such point after the following number of communication rounds. Here, capital O hides numerical factors, and also it hides smoothness constants because in order to for the ease of exposition, we omit here all dependencies on the smoothness constants. And let us look closer at this complexity bound. So we see here that the dependence on epsilon is optimal only for the first term because we use full gradients. So the optimal complexity is epsilon to the power -2 according to known lower bounds. And But we also have terms that depend on epsilon to the power minus 4, and this can be bad when the target accuracy epsilon is small. But for a large number of workers, it can be this negative effect can be reduced of the dependence on epsilon. Okay, so next we see here that the dependence on omega is only in the second and the third term, and it depends like it's proportional to omega, and this is NOK dependence, and also delta zero is the difference between the functional value at the starting point and the lower bound, and this term delta f star is in general bigger than zero, and it cannot be reduced. So it can be large, for example, because here we use f star is lower bound for the average function, and fi star is lower bound for individual loss functions. So if the problem is not over-parameterized, meaning that all functions have the same minimum, same optimal value, for example, if the problem is not over-parameterized, this term is not zero in general. Okay, but nevertheless, the dependence on epsilon is not optimal in this method, and that is why alternative approaches are needed. And there exists an alternative approach, and it is called Diana. It was developed in 2019, and it looks very similar to QGD. And we can actually write the update rule in the same way, but the difference will be in the way how we define GIK. In QGD, let me remind you that in QGD, GIK is just quantized version of the true gradient, but in Diana, GIK is computed in more sophisticated way. So if you look at QGD here, well, when we are close to the stationary point, gradients of individual loss functions are not necessarily close to zero. And that is why, since the quantization operator produces variance that scales, that can be proportional to the squared norm of the input vector, it means that even if we are close to the solution, the variance can be large. And here, in the end, the main trick is to introduce these shifts, HIK, and the goal of the shifts is to converge to the of each individual as individual shifts HIK. The goal for them is to converge to some to the gradient of Fi at the point where we converge, at the stationary point where we converge. So in this case, when HIK is close to the point where we converge, then this guy will be small, and therefore the variance of the of this quantized gradient, quantized difference, will be also small because it's upper bounded relatively by the squared norm of the input vector, and that is why we'll have less noise. The estimates will be less noisy, and this is why this method converges better. This is mainly the intuition of the method. And I would like to emphasize that in QGD, we need to send only quantized gradients, only quantized vectors. And in Diana, we also need to send only quantized vectors because the server needs to, because the server can store an average of HIKs, and that is why it can update the average of GIKs using only the quantized differences, these ones. these differences. And one can prove that Diana has the following communication complexity. And here the dependence on epsilon is optimal. The dependence on omega is slightly worse than in QGD. Let me show you once again. So in QGD, the dependence on omega in these terms is like the power of one. And in Diana, it's when omega is much bigger than one, the dependence on omega is proportional to omega to the power 3/2. And the natural question appears, how to improve this dependence on omega? Because when we use compression operators like rand k, omega is proportional to d over k, and typically number of peaked components is small, k is small. Therefore, we want this complexity, we want this dependence to be better. And the answer is yes, it is possible to get better rates. And in order to do that, we need to, we proposed a new method called Marina. The main difference between Marina and Diana is that in Marina, we use, instead of HIKs, so it is natural to use the gradient at the previous point, because as I said, HIK was supposed to be an approximation of the gradients at the stationary point where we converge. But it is natural to use the gradient from the previous iteration because it's already a good approximation, and it becomes increasingly better during the optimization process. And so it is natural to use, instead of HIK, it is natural to use the gradient at the previous point. So, and here we use this idea. And also we have a slightly different formula for GIK. So with small probability P, we use dense vectors. So with small probability, all clients send dense vectors. And with much larger probability, they need to send only quantized gradient differences. So this vector is known from the previous iteration, and each client just needs to compute this gradient, compute the difference, and compute quantization. Yeah. And again, as in Diana, we only need to send quantized gradient differences with large probability. And do not need to send this guy, because it can be stored on the server and updated on the server. Yeah, and another difference between Marina and Diana is that in Marina, GK is an unbiased estimate of the true gradient, while in Marina, GK is no longer conditionally unbiased estimate of the true gradient, and it slightly complicates the analysis of the method. And in our work, we proved the following convergence result, complexity result. So it's optimal dependence on epsilon and better dependence on omega. And actually, using lower bounds for derivative-free optimization, one can show that dependence on omega is also optimal here, because rand k operator can be considered as for k equals one, it can be considered as randomized coordinate descent type of methods, and so it is close to zero order methods, and so one can establish a lower bound that the resulting complexity should be should depend on the dimension s. Depends on the dimension linearly. Yeah, and this result is derived for the following choice of P, and it is natural choice for wide range of compression operators because it's proportional to the zeta q over d, and zeta q is an expected density of the compression operator. So, and if you use such p, on average at each iteration we send two times zeta q components. So, and the improvement is square root of omega here in comparison to Diana. So this is the main contribution of the paper, and let me briefly show you some numerical results. So we consider the following problem. It's a non-convex optimization problem, and it is needed for binary classification. And we consider data sets from LibSWM library, and each data set was split into five equal parts among five clients, and we use theoretical step sizes. And we obtained that in all experiments, Marina outperforms Diana with different NK compression operators, both in terms of loss and in terms of squared norm of the gradient, and also outperforms in comparison to communication rounds and in terms of transferred bits per worker. So, in conclusion, I would like to say that in the paper we also have variance reduced version for finite sum problems when each client has finite sum. We also have variance reduced method for variance reduced version of Marina for this kind of problems. Also, we derive rates under polyclay ACH condition. And also we have, I forgot to mention this in the slide, but we also have Marina with partial participation of clients. And also in the paper, you can find explicit dependencies on smoothness constants and non-uniform sampling. And what is important, our proofs are simple, and the results are strictly better than previous known results. So thank you for your attention. Now I'll be happy to answer your questions.
It seems that everything is clear. Very nice talk, thank you.